For more videos on people's struggles, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Hello, welcome to People's Dispatch and Globetrotter. Events in Turkey have shaken the world. Once again, the president of Turkey has decided that the best way forward is by banning a political party, or at least trying to. We're trying to make sense of what's happening in Turkey, a major country that straddles both Asia and Europe. We're very fortunate today to have with us Ertuğrul Kürçü from the very important post of the honorary president of the People's Democratic Party, HDP. The HDP, of course, is the party that is being put under the gun in Turkey. Ertuğrul, welcome to People's Dispatch and Globetrotter.
Hello.
So could you just tell us a little bit about the mood in Turkey? You know, the president has, in 3 years, I think, or 2 years, has thrown out three heads of the central bank. The Turkish government has decided to walk away from, well, it's called the Istanbul Convention, you know, the convention for against violence against women. And then, of course, once more, many times since 1990, but once more, the Turkish state has attempted to ban the political formation of both Kurdish society, but also of the Turkish left. What's going on in Turkey? Give us a sense of the mood, please.
Yeah, we can speak about a permanent crisis that Turkey is passing through. There are very short instances of a kind of a equilibrium or stabilization in the modern Turkish history of the last 50 years, as far as I know. The remaining is a permanent crisis. This stems from two points. One of them is between the state and society. Turkish state does not fit Turkish society. Ethnic, multi-class, multi-gender, multinational, multi-everything society inherited from the former Ottoman Empire. But the government or the state is either a single party state of the Turkish nationalists, or at the single party state of the Islamists. So this produces and reproduces crisis. It's the second economic crisis, and which is now aggravated by the COVID-19 crisis that the Turkish government cannot handle. Now, all these superimposed and creating a lot of burdens for the Tayyip Erdoğan regime to exist, because the country is very deeply polarized, 50% against 50%, and HDP is in the middle. Whichever side HDP tends, this side is going to win. And HDP is now tending for the last 20 years with the opposition. Indeed, we call ourselves as the third pole, not belonging to either camps of the polarization, but the situation of a crisis which pushes Tayyip Erdoğan to progress in the direction of establishing a fascist dictatorship. HDP is now seeking to set up a broad democratic front, including all anti-presidential forces in Turkey. Therefore, this makes HDP the most important figure in this sense, in terms of a political lineup of forces. And the other side of the picture is that HDP is based on the democratic momentum produced by the Kurdish liberation struggle. This is a challenge both for the nation state and also for the single party state, which is based on Turkish Islamism. Therefore, HDP is the first, although it's the third power in Turkey, it is the first power to be eradicated by the Tayyip Erdoğan regime. And therefore, HDP comprises everything that the ruling class, the ruling elite, the ruling party is hating and looking to annihilate. It's a women's party, it's a Kurdish party, it's a workers' party, it's an intellectual party, it's the party of the others, and it's the party of Kurds and Alawites. All elements which have been excluded from the official society by either the Islamist elite or the Turkish elite. Therefore, this is why HDP is that heavily targeted, and why the crisis is revolving around annihilating HDP. But since Turkey is also carrying with itself the heritage of 100 years of democratic struggles, it's not as easy as to crush everything that you can do in Afghanistan. Turkey is not Afghanistan, but Turkey is not Italy either. Therefore, we have a very complex society, and in this complexity, we can both retain in a degree our legitimacy and legality, but on the other hand, we are becoming the basic sufferers of the creeping fascism in Turkey, to make a very long story short.
Well, you have, of course, been involved in Turkish politics since, at least 1968. You're one of the generation of 1968. You're a veteran of the Turkish left. But you've also, of course, been involved in those emancipatory struggles of the Kurdish people. One of the interesting things, you're the honorary president of the HDP, but the HDP, which was formed formally in 2012, didn't emerge out of nowhere. It emerged out of over a decade of the attempt of both the Kurdish emancipatory struggles and the Turkish left to create legitimate democratic platforms. It's very interesting, Atul, that there are so many parties. They keep appearing with the name democratic in them, starting with the HEP in 1990, the Democratic Labour Party and so on. They keep getting banned. 1990 it's set up, banned 93, set up 95, banned 96, set up 96, banned 98, etc., etc. OZDEP, DEP, one after the other. This attempt to create, to found an emancipatory project, both of the Kurdish people and of the Turkish left, constantly getting banned. You yourself were a member of the Grand National Assembly. You won a seat from the beautiful city of Izmir. You've been part of the attempt to democratize Turkish society. And yet, as you say, the HDP right now is what the Turkish state is trying to erase. I just want some more on this reason why the attempt to found a democratic project that unites the Turkish left and the Kurdish emancipatory forces is so threatening, to the Turkish state.
This is directly related by the raison d'etat of the Turkish statism. This is a nation state built by the state itself. Indeed, when the Anatolia was rescued from occupation in 1920s after the liberation war fought against imperialist occupation, it was the last piece of land remaining from this huge Ottoman Empire. And this land was filled with people of various descents. Turks could be the majority, but there were also the Kurds. And the Armenian genocide was just 5 years behind, and the Pontus genocide was 2 years behind, and the Turkishness was something to be, because the Ottoman emperors didn't call themselves Turks, they were Ottomans, and Turks were the ordinary people, and these were not the the absolute majority. They were the majority, but non-Turks, Christians, Jews, Alawites, Kurds, a motley background of people were living in this space. In order to bring about a nation state out of this heritage from Ottoman Empire, first the National Assembly, who fought the Liberation War, looked for local democracies in 1921. The first constitution was referring to local democracies, but those were the days of the light of the Soviet Revolution radiated across Turkey. So this much of freedom for the emerging bourgeoisie was too much. So we should have a compact nation state without that much of a local power. Therefore, the central power should be united around the Turkishness, or the Turkism inherited from the Ottoman times, the leading party of Ittihat Terakki, Unity and Progress Party. And the mentality of those, that age's nationality was translated into Turkish realities. And finally, we had a one party nation state over this motley background. So in order to keep all the others under control, Turks should also be left with the substandard democracy. So autocracy or Bonapartism or one party regime for the Kurds, and the annihilation, liquidation, assimilation for the Kurds and the others. You cannot have a democratic state on this base. This is the major reason modernization from above creates those results. This somehow we can compare this with the modernization of Germany with blood and iron. That's the Alaturka way of German modernization in Turkey, which left no space for oppressed classes, oppressed nations, oppressed genders to come out in an independent way. Therefore, a state excluding civil society, there's no space for consent in this at this point, just blunt force. Only after 1950s, after the end of the Second World War, when the world changed into liberal democracies and communism, the polarization in the world pushed Turkey to liberal democracies, so you couldn't stay with the remain with a single party. There should be multi-party situation, and the situation change. And from this crack evolves all the democratic tendencies of Turkey in the last 50 years. And all the progress that the European democracies made in 500 years, Turkey is trying to make in the in 50 years. So this is a very rapid replay of the democratic struggles of the 19th century in the 21st century, if this is somehow descriptive of what we have been through.
That's a very interesting perspective, this perspective of the compressed time frame in which Turkey is trying to advance a democratic process. I want to come directly, Ertuğrul, to the sensitive issue. In 1978, in the middle of quite harsh repression of Turkey's southwest, some young people created the Kurdish Workers' Party, yeah. The PKK. The PKK has, of course, had a long-standing problem for the Turkish state. There's been periodic wars, attacks on the southwest and so on. The leader of the PKK has been in prison outside Istanbul for a very long time. Abdullah Öcalan has been in prison for a long time and so on. Consistently since 1990, these formations of the Turkish left and Kurdish emancipation keep getting banned because they are accused of associating with the PKK, the Kurdish Workers' yeah. Party, which is itself banned. This is exactly what one of the leaders of the HDP has been sitting in jail since November 2016.
Yeah.
Salahattin has been in jail, now for, good God, I mean, so many years, accused of, again, associating with the PKK, egging the PKK on during the Kobani riots of 2014, and so on and so forth. The attack on the HDP is saying that, well, you're a front for the PKK. What is your position on this? Why is there this constant attempt to make this linkage, particularly given the fact that the Turkish state has wanted to negotiate with Öcalan, has wanted to negotiate with the PKK, in fact, wants the armed struggle to disappear? Why is there this attack? Why not open up the political space for a conversation?
I want to start with the result and come back to the effects. The result is related to the story that I tried to tell for the previous question. Under those circumstances, opening up a democratic space for all those elements who have been neglected or oppressed during the previous 50 years or 100 years means the end of the supremacy of Turkishness. So after then, you cannot have a state based on one ethnicity. You cannot have a state based on one belief. Or a privileged belief. You cannot have a state based on one class. Everything should be democratized. This means, sharing power with the people, and particularly Turks sharing power with Kurds. This means leaving your eastern borders to the patriotism of Kurds, leaving your major waters because Tigris and the Euphrates are the major waters in the Middle East, and they are born in Turkey and they are of the Kurdish land. So all the riches and all the strategic advantages that you have, you should share them with the consent of the Kurds. So for Turkish status, this is the end of the world, because the world was a Turkish state. And now you are sharing it with someone else, with someone that you had fought for decades to annihilate, to assimilate, to destroy. But they have emerged and re-emerged throughout the centuries, because you keep only a part of them in your country. They are also existing in Iraq. They are also existing in Syria and also in Iran. Then you come back to a point that the Kurdish issue is not only a local issue, but it is also international. So, for the Turkish statism, there are times that tell the ongoing conflict, some openings for concessions starts, but from these concessions, Kurds appear with their full right for self-determination. So the Turkish state would decide, okay, only we can make self-determination in Turkey, others not. So then comes the closure period or the suppression period. But now come back to the first part of the question. The Kurdish struggle in 1970s gained a new character. Previously, the state oppression was reacted by insurrections of the peasantry. And they were immediately killed and annihilated, and a pogrom or even a local genocide followed. But this time, a young generation of revolutionaries, inspired by Turkish revolutionism of 1968, decided to start a modern warfare of guerrilla struggle based on Kurdish people's rights and liberties, and organizing them as a modern power around a modern ideology. This was like a dream for the former generations of Kurds and the Turks. But a person, Öcalan, he looked like a lunatic at the first moment. This couldn't happen, but he dared. And he gained at the end attachment and devotedness of a young generation of revolutionaries, and they started this war. And this is the basic element which revitalized the understanding of Kurds of themselves, that we are a different ethnicity, we have rights, we have to gain them, we have the right to self-determination, and we can do this only together with the other democratic forces. Formerly, the Kurdish uprising were local ones, and they had no connection whatsoever with the other elements of the Turkish society. But with the modernization, a growing working class, and the emigration from the Kurdish lands to the metropolitan hubs of industry and commerce created a huge Kurdish intelligentsia, which is in very close cooperation with Turkish left. And this created the historical destiny that the Kurdish and Turkish struggles could merge together. HDP is the realization of this. It's not a standard Kurdish legal party which blurred out those rare instances of liberal periods, but this is a decisive attempt by the Kurds themselves to self-determine their destiny in Turkey. Restructuring the Turkish state based on local democracies, a kind of reference to 1921 constitution. Therefore, this attempt changed a lot of things, and it's difficult for the Turkish state now to ban it once and at all and close it very immediately. They cannot do it because through this process, also the ruling AKP also gained some, consent from the Kurdish public during this negotiation process across the Kurdish society. So therefore, a very, an abrupt change of everything might lose them everything that they gained through the Muslim Kurdish population that they gained some consent. It's somehow complicated, but the issue is that now we have something very much different, both for the Turkish left, for the Kurdish left, Kurdish nationalism, Turkish statehood, this attempt, determination for gaining full citizens' rights and the national rights by restructuring Turkey. Therefore, not setting up a secessionist movement, but an intact a movement for reintegration. This has changed all the elements of the play that we had witnessed in the previous decades. This is the present situation, and of course, this has this makes the Kurdish issue an international one, and this now puts forward international tasks also for the Turkish left. So you cannot see the issue inside the Turkish boundaries. It's a regional and international issue. So if you are an internationalist force, you should act accordingly. That is how the left inside HDP is now handling the issues. And this is also a short answer for a century story.
It's very illuminating how in the middle of a political crisis where your political party is seeking to be banned, you take the long perspective, 100 years this year of Turkey's experiment with local democracy. You're looking ahead saying we cannot be defeated. Ertuğrul Kukçu, Honorary President of the People's Democratic Party, HDP in Turkey. Thank you so much for joining us at People's Dispatch and Globetrotter.
Thank you for inviting. It was a pleasure.